بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم. Beloved brothers and sisters, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. I could gather that when you don't see the table and the chair, you must know I'm not lecturing today. So we have the stand here, but we are honored and it is a pleasure to have Sheikh Fakhruddin with us once again to address us. Inshallah, Sheikh Fakhruddin, I think we have introduced him enough in the past. So we're going to ask Sheikh Fakhruddin to address us, inshallah, so we can all benefit from his sermon and his wisdom, inshallah. Fadal Sheikh Fakhruddin.
Alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salamu ala Sayyidina Rasulillah, wa ala alihi wa ashabihi man walah. Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad al-Fatih lima ughliq wa al-Khatim lima sabaq. ناصر الحق بالحق والهادي إلى صراطك المستقيم وعلى آله حق قدره ومقداره العظيم أما بعد. All praise and thanks is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our creator, our provider, our supporter, our protector, our owner. To him we belong and to him we shall return. And greetings and salutes to his messenger, the best of his creation, Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, upon his noble family, the Ahlul Bayt, his honorable companions, the Sahaba, and all those who walk in their footsteps till the day of judgment, and may we all be with them as well. Ameen ya Rabbal Alameen. Thereafter, I greet you with the greetings of peace and mercy. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillah, brothers and sisters in Islam, we are now coming towards the end, the second half of the month of Safar. And the month after that is Rabi'ul Awwal. And this month of Safar, it was in these days of Safar, the last 2 weeks of Safar, that our Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam's final illness started. And it was an illness that ended with him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam leaving this dunya. So this final illness of our Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam started in the month of Safar, and then in the beginning of Rabi'ul Awwal, our Nabi alayhi salatu wa sallam became a little bit better, and then once again the sickness came back, the illness came back, and then he went to meet his Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala. But I do not want to narrate to you the entire story of the passing away of our Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. That is a topic of its own. But what I want to talk about this afternoon is some of the advices or the advice that our Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam gave to his ummah at that stage of his life, which is the last stage of his life, the final moments, the final weeks of his life. So the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they narrate that our Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, in the last days of his life, like a week or so, 2 weeks maybe maximum, before he passed away, they say, he took a walk. And they said, when we saw him walking, we started walking with him. And they say he walked, and initially we didn't know where he was going. But we walked, as Imam Muslim narrates, they said, until he came to the qubur of the shuhada of Uhud. Sayyidina Hamza, Sayyid al-Shuhada, radiyallahu anhu. He came there to the graveyard of the martyrs of the Battle of Badr, Battle of Uhud, mind you. And that is a mountain in Medina, it's called Uhud, Jabal Uhud. And it's about 45 minutes to an hour's walk from the Haram. So he walked all that distance to get there to the mountain where the qubur are, the graves are of the martyrs of Uhud, the leader of whom is Sayyidina Hamza, his uncle. So he stood there by those qubur making their ziyarah. He was making ziyarah, he greeted them, and then he was praying for them and making dua for them. He lifted up his hands and he made duas there. Some of the du'as the Sahaba remembered, some of them were soft, they didn't remember. But they say, after he did that, then he walked back. And we went back with him to the masjid. And some of the Sahaba said it was the way he was standing so long by those graves was in a way he was, the way they picked up from him was, it's as if he was telling them, I'm joining you very soon. He's telling his uncle Hamza, I'm joining you very soon. As if that is what was going on there. Because he stood there longer than usual. He would go to visit them often. The Shuhada of Uhud, he would make ziyarah often, but he wouldn't stand that long. How long he stood that time. Anyways, they say he went back to the Masjid al-Nabawi, and as he came back to the Masjid, we all walked with him, and then when he came to the Masjid, he stood on his mimbar. He stood on his mimbar, and when he stands on the mimbar, it means he wants to say something. So then he said some things to the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, some nasiha, which applies to all of us till the day of Qiyamah. He made, before the nasiha, he made a prediction. He predicted something. He says, first and foremost, he said, before anything else, that indeed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave a servant of his the choice of remaining in the dunya or going towards the akhirah. So that servant chose the akhirah. Chose the akhirah. So many of the sahaba sitting in the jama'ah, they didn't understand what he's talking about. But Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq started crying. So they said to him, why do you cry? He said, he's speaking about himself. Don't you guys realize what he's talking about? They're like, we're not sure. What's he? He said, he's speaking about himself. And he cried and he cried. And that's why when the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam passed away, Sayyidina Abu Bakr didn't cry too much at that moment. He was the strongest one at that moment. Why? Wasn't he sad? He was sad, but he had cried already. He had cried already. It's like when you cried before they go, you already cried for them. So when they go, you are quiet. And that's how he controlled the moment. But anyways, he cried. And the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam then said, and I want to give you, he said, the prediction to his ummah. He said, indeed I'm leaving. And indeed, لا أخاف أن تشركوا بعدي. He said, I do not fear that you will commit shirk after me. I do not fear that you will commit shirk after me. I do not fear that you will commit kufr, you will leave this deen after me. I don't fear that. Alhamdulillah, I brought everybody in the deen. I don't fear that my ummah will leave this deen. So that is the first point. I don't fear that for my ummah. Kufr and shirk. And then he said, وَلَكِنِّي أَخَافُ أَن تَتَنَافَسُوا عَلَيْهَا فَلَا تَرْجِعُوا بَعْدِي كُفَّارًا يَضْرِبُ بَعْدَكُمْ رِقَابَ بَعْضٍ. He says, but I fear that you will fight over this dunya. What I fear is that you will fight amongst each other. So do not behave like kuffar after me, killing each other. Do not act like kuffar after me, fighting each other like kuffar. So in this short statement, our Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, it tells us two things, two very important things. One is that there is no fear for this ummah to become kafir or mushrik. لا خاف عليكم أن تشركوا بعدي. He said, I don't fear that you're going to commit shirk after me. So therefore, if anybody comes today and wants to accuse the Muslimin of kufr and shirk, then they are contradicting what the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said. The Nabi alayhi salatu wa sallam said, my ummah will not commit shirk after me. Meaning, what is shirk? To worship other than Allah. To have another God besides Allah. He predicted that's not going to happen. Because that's what happened with the ummahs before him. The nation that came before him was the nation of Isa alayhi salam. And what happened with them? They worshipped Nabi Isa alayhi salam and they committed shirk and kufr. And they made him into God. The Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made it clear, that's not going to happen in my ummah. That's not going to happen. So if somebody accuses the Muslims of shirk and kufr, then they are contradicting our Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They need to stop condemning other Muslims and they need to start fixing their own way of thinking. They need to start correcting their own way of thinking if they are busy condemning everybody else. Because that means they don't understand what's going on. Because the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam's words cannot be wrong. He made it clear. My ummah is not going to be committing shirk after me. But what will be happening is exactly what's happening today. He said, but I fear that the shaitan will disunite you and then make you fight amongst each other. So he then warned the ummah, you will not become kafir after me. But Do not behave like kuffar after me. How? يَضْرِبُ بَعْضَكُمْ رِقَابَ بَعْضٍ. Killing each other. Attacking each other and striking each other's heads off. Because at that time the Sahaba, they used to fight the kuffar, and the kuffar used to strike their heads off, and they used to strike the enemy's head off. The Nabi ﷺ told the Sahaba, but after me, I fear for the ummah that you will behave with each other like kuffar. So you will not become kuffar. Hey, that's not what he fears. But what he fears is that we will behave like kuffar. In what way? In the sense that we will fight and kill each other. And that was the last nasiha of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from the mimbar. Because after that he didn't go on the mimbar again. So we have to take heed of this advice of our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The first point, my ummah will not commit kufr after me. It is sad today that despite the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us that, it is so easy today for us as Muslims to accuse each other of kufr and shirk. And we forget that to accuse another Muslim of kufr is a major sin. In fact, it is so great that it can sometimes make you a kafir also. The Nabi alayhi salatu wa salam said, "Man qala li akhihi ya kafir faqad baha bihi ahaduhuma." That if you call your brother Muslim who says La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah, if you call him a kafir and he is not a kafir in the sight of Allah, then on the day of Qiyamah you will be resurrected as a kafir. Not in the dunya. In the dunya you are still a Muslim. Yeah, a Muslim, you know, you live, die as a Muslim. But in the akhirah, because that's the reality, you will be resurrected as a kafir. That alone should make us very, very scared to accuse anybody of kufr or being a kafir. Because if they are not, then we are the ones who are resurrected on the day of Qiyamah as kuffar. Why? Because we are playing the role of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you say about another Muslim, he is a kafir, what you are basically saying is that his nikah is broken with his wife, his children cannot inherit from him anymore, he cannot be allowed to come inside the masjid again, because he's murtad in that sense, he cannot be buried with the Muslimin when he dies, you cannot have a janazah salah for him, and in the akhirah, he is to enter the fire forever. Now brothers and sisters, I don't know, I'm too scared to make that judgment about anybody who says, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadur Rasulullah. Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can make those type of verdicts and those type of judgments on people. So we have to be very, very careful. There is a story, in the time of the Nabi alayhi salatu wa salam, he sent some of the Sahaba to battle, and in that battle, the commander of the Muslim army, Sayyidina Usama bin Zayd radiallahu an, a beloved one of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Usama radiallahu an, he was fighting one of the kuffar, and as he was fighting him, the guy was hitting him and he was hitting him, and they were fighting and fighting, and finally Usama got on top of him. And he got the chance now to kill him, finally. Because they are in war, in battle. But just as Usama was about to kill the guy, the man started shouting, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. But Usama killed him anyways. Killed him anyways. Now some of the Sahaba, they saw that. And they reported that to the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Not to hurt Usama, but because they want to know, was it right or wrong what he did? Because we might face the same situation when we fight the enemy. So when the Nabi alayhi salatu wa sallam heard about that, he called Usama. And Usama was like an adopted child of our Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rasulullah used to raise him up in his own home. He used to carry Sayyidina al-Hasan and Sayyidina al-Husayn and Usama with them in his lap. Three of them had in his lap. He called Usama and he said to his known as Hibbu Rasulullah or Ibn Hibbu Rasulullah. He called Usama and he said, Usama, what happened? What do I hear about what you did? He said, yes, Ya Rasulullah, the man was trying to kill me and I fought him. And finally when I was about to kill him, he said, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, just to save his life, so I killed him. Because I can't let him go, then what if he comes and attacks me again? So the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam looked at Usama and he said, أَقَتَلْتَهُ بَعْدَ أَنْ قَالَ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. He said, oh Usama, you killed him after he said, La ilaha illallah. So Usama said, yes, Ya Rasulullah, but that was just, he didn't mean it. He just said it to protect his life. That's the easiest way to get away. So the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam asked him again, أَقَتَلْتَهُ بَعْدَانْ قَالَ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. Oh Usama, you killed him after he said, لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. Then Usama said again, yes, Ya Rasulullah, but he, it was just to protect his life. He didn't mean it. Then the Nabi Alayhi Salatu Wasalam said for the third time, أَقَتَلْتَهُ بَعْدَانْ قَالَ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. Oh Usama, you killed him after he said, لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. So Usama then started shaking and trembling and tears started coming from his eyes. It's like when somebody you love scolds you, your ustad, your father. So he said, Ya Rasulullah, but he didn't mean it. So then the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam looked at him and said, Halla shakakta an qalbih? He said, Oh Usama, did you open his heart to see? Did you open up his heart to see if he meant it or he didn't mean it? Man qala la ilaha illallah. فَقَدْ عَصِمَ مِنِّي مَالُهُ وَدَمُهُ. He said, whosoever says La ilaha illallah, then his blood and his wealth is safe from us. Usama radiallahu anhu was so sad that day. He said, Wallahi, I wish I hadn't been born before that day. He said, I was so embarrassed in front of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I wish I was born after that day. But the point is that this is how much respect and sacredness our Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave to the kalima of La ilaha illallah. And we are not to open the hearts of people. If he said La ilaha illallah, he is your brother in Islam, and his wealth and his life is haram on you. And his honor is haram on you. Usama radiallahu anhu didn't say, okay, you said La ilaha illallah, brother, but can you please read for me the five pillars of Islam, and the six pillars of Iman, and the entire Aqidah book. What do you believe about, what's your opinion, should you make Eid with Makkah or with the moon? First answer that, then I'm going to kill you. Then I'll decide. What's your opinion on this? Usama didn't ask him a million questions. If he said, La ilaha illallah, khalas, that's enough. Today we've added 1,000 more conditions. Before I consider you a Muslim brother, there's 1,000 questions you have to answer first. All my opinions, all my biases, all my mazhabs, my aqidas, La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah is not enough anymore. You believe in Allah and His Messenger? Yes. No, that's not good enough. Do you believe in my Sheikh? No, okay, then you're not a Muslim. Do you believe in my mazhab? No, okay, then you're not a Muslim. Do you pray like me? Where you hold your hand in salah? Up here, down here, or you don't hold the hand? We have added 1,000 more things to it, but for the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it was one simple thing. Oh Usama, you killed him after he said, La ilaha illallah. And you know what? The man probably didn't mean it as well. I'm with Usama on this one. That, I'm sure he didn't mean it. But, Usama is right about that. The man probably didn't mean it. It was just to save his life. But he was wrong in killing the man after he said those words. Because as the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, we are not to open the hearts of people. If somebody says that kalima, they are our brothers in Islam and they are our brothers in this deen. So we have to be careful, brothers and sisters in Islam. The Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam warned of fitna and khilaf and division in the ummah. He said, "Inna shaytana qad yaisa an yu'bada fi jazirati al-arabi ba'da yawmikum hadha." He said, "The shaytan has lost all hope that he will ever be worshipped again in this land of Arabia of yours." Walakin lam yayas fi at-taharrush baynakum. But he has not lost hope in dividing you and making you kill each other. So the Nabi sallallahu alaihi says, "You will not become kuffar after me, but you may behave like kuffar after me." How? When you fight and you may call each other kafir and kill each other. You look at the Muslim Ummah today, that is exactly what we see happening. Sayyidina Khalid bin al-Walid radiallahu anhu, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent him on one campaign as well, and the fighting was going on, and he arrived at that camp in the night time, and those people were fighting Islam, but when he arrived, before he had arrived, they had decided to accept Islam. But he didn't know, so when he arrived there, they started shouting at him in the night, when he attacked them, assalamu alaikum, assalamu alaikum, we are Muslim, we are, but they started saying it in a way that Khalid didn't understand in their other accent. Saba'na, Saba'na, and they usually would say Aslamna. So Khalid radiallahu anhu nevertheless killed many of them because he thought he's still at war. Other Sahaba, they didn't agree with what he did. They said, but you know, we heard them say. So they reported that to the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The next day, when they returned to the Nabi alayhi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam called Khalid radiallahu anhu. He said, Khalid, what happened there? He said, I attacked and they were shouting some things and in the night time I didn't hear what they were saying. Rasulullah said, is it true that you killed them after they said, Salaam alaikum. And after they said, we are Muslim, Khalid said, I didn't understand what they were saying at the time of the night. My order was to attack and I didn't hear them properly. So the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, then why didn't you wait and understand? Then why didn't you wait and listen to them carefully what they were doing and what they were saying? But the others heard it, and he looked at other Sahaba. Did you hear what they said? They said, yes, we heard them. They said, Assalamu alaikum, we are Muslim. So then the Nabi alayhi salatu was salam lifted up his hands and he said three times, Allahumma inni abra'u ilayk mimma sana'a Khalid. Three times he said, oh Allah, I distance myself from what Khalid has done. Three times he apologized to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said, ya Allah, I distance myself from what Khalid has done. Oh Allah, I distance myself from what Khalid has done. Oh Allah, I distance myself from what Khalid has done. Because he killed people after they said, la ilaha illallah. After they said, assalamu alaikum. And the ayah was revealed. La taqulu liman alqa alaykum assalam alastam mu'min. Don't say to those who say assalamu alaykum to you, you're not a Muslim. And then Khalid radiallahu anhu, he accepted his mistake and he apologized and he said he promised he will not do that again. He accepted, he made tawbah. And then the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he didn't just stop at that. He sent Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu to that people, that tribe. And he sent him with a lot of sheep and a lot of camels. And he said to him, go and find out how many of them were killed and pay every single one of them the blood money that is due to them. Because if you kill somebody by mistake, you have to pay them the blood money. So, if you kill somebody intentionally in Islam, then you are executed. But if you kill somebody by mistake, you have to pay them the blood money. Khalid killed them by mistake. So Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam got every one of them paid. And he gave them extra. This is how much sacredness the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave to the blood of a Muslim. Today, we disagree with each other, and immediately we call the next person a kafir, and we make his blood halal. It's okay to beat him up, it's okay to attack him, it's okay to kill him. We see it happening in the Muslim world. I feel safe speaking to you here, on the minbar of this masjid here in Cape Town. Because wallahi, in the Muslim world, many places in the Muslim world, there are people who are killing even ulama inside the masajid. On the day of Jum'ah. Can you believe it? If you don't believe it, then hear it from me. In the Muslim world now, not every Muslim country, but in many Muslim countries, it is common for a group that disagrees with that group to go into their Jum'ah and blow up the masjid during Jum'ah time. With the sheikh and all the musallis. It's happening in Somalia. It's happening in Yemen. It happened in Saudi Arabia, it happened in Kuwait, in Iraq every day, in Syria it happened, in many other places. They will not be scared to blow up the entire masjid. In Nigeria it happened, Boko Haram, and they were doing it, they were blowing up masjid during Salatul Jum'ah, with the imam and everybody in it. Why? You know why they do it? If you tell them, but are you not a Muslim brother? How can you as a Muslim blow up a masjid during the time of Jum'ah? When the musallis are there, you know what he tells you? No, because Allah's kuffar. Because they are kafir. I will never kill a Muslim brother. But those people in that masjid and that imam and all those people, they are kuffar. Who told you they are kuffar? Some sheikh, he convinced me that they are kuffar. Wallahi. And then the guy thinks he's doing a great ibadah by blowing up all these kuffar. Do you see now how dangerous it is to call other people kuffar, to call Muslims as kuffar, because it is just one step away from killing them. And that is what's happening in the Muslims. That's why I said, I feel safe here. Alhamdulillah, we have not gone that far, alhamdulillah. And when I say this, that we should be careful of not calling each other kuffar, I do not mean by that we cannot have differences. Of course we have differences. There are many differences in the ummah. We are Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. There are others who are Shia or Salafi or this or that. So there's many, many groups out there. But we are all part of one ummah. The Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he said, my ummah will be divided into different groups, you know what he said? He said, my ummah will be divided into different groups. He called them all my ummah. It's still my ummah. So yes, you can be right and the other one can be wrong. But you can say that he is wrong without calling him a kafir, without asking for violence against him, without calling for his head. The Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, yes, he used to, call to the people, but he did not call for their heads, he did not preach violence against them, unless they attacked him. Never. The head of the munafiqs in Medina, the man that accused our mother Sayyidah Aisha radiallahu anha of wrong things and so on. This evil man in Medina, Abdullah bin Ubay bin Salul, head of the munafiqs in Medina. His son was a good Muslim. Father is a big munafiq. He insulted the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Let me count to you what this man did. Authentically, he used to insult the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He called the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam something so bad I can't even repeat it. He insulted the wife of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Sayyidah Aisha. And he said again things that I cannot repeat. You know, repeating bad things is not good. Even if you are quoting somebody else. And he is to insult the Sahaba of the Nabi. So he is to make fun of the Sahaba of the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And they sit with the Nabi, he laughs at them. This is all in the hadith. This evil man. His son was a good Muslim. One day his son came, when he heard all these insults, his son came to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, Ya Rasulullah, if you allow me, I know how my father is hurting you, hurting your wives, hurting your Sahaba. He's hurting the Muslimin. I know what type of man he is, and I know how angry the Muslims are with him. But if you allow me, Ya Rasulullah, I would like to go kill him right now. And bring his head and put it by your feet. Allow me, Ya Rasulullah, to do that. Subhanallah. Look at how, if somebody deserved it, it's that man. Yet the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam looked at his son, he said, No, O Abdullah. The son's name was Abdullah. He said, No, O Abdullah. I do not allow you to do that. Bal ashirhu bil ma'rufi ma dama hayya. Rather, be nice to him as long as he is alive. Because he is still your father. He is still your father. Not your brother in Islam. He is still your father. I do not allow you to do that. Be good to him as long as he is alive. Why? Firstly, because he is your father. And secondly, when you maintain that good akhlaq with him, maybe it will change his heart. Maybe he will come right. Maybe Rasulullah used to have hope for people. He didn't write off people. Today we, he disagreed with me. He's a write off. Khalas, forget about him. Rasulullah always had hope for people, always wanted the people to come right. So brothers and sisters in Islam, I conclude once again with the words of the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. He said, just 2 weeks before he passed away, he stood on the mimbar and he said to his sahaba, his final words to the ummah from the mimbar, he said, O people, I do not fear that you will commit kufr or shirk, you will commit shirk after me. I don't fear that. But I fear that you will behave like kuffar with each other by attacking and killing each other. We should, therefore all of us here should be agents of peace. I cannot stop the wars that are happening in Syria and Iraq and Yemen. That's beyond me. But what we can do is always be agents of sulh. If you see two Muslims fighting, don't flare the fire. Don't throw more coal into the fire. Try to be an agent of sulh. Try to be an agent of peace. If there is khilaf in any community, whatever it is, racial khilaf, mazhab khilaf, ethnic khilaf, whatever it is, try to be somebody who's trying to bring them together. If you can't bring them together, then at least make dua for that. Say, Oh Allah, lumma shammal muslimin, unite the Muslims. Rather than take sides and flare the conflicts even more and make the people hate each other even more, make dua for hidayah, make dua for rahmah and peace. Our enemies are planning against us and we need to be united against them. Otherwise, as Allah says, if you are not united, then I will take away all power and strength from you and then your enemies will do with you whatever they want. And that's exactly what's happening right now. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unite the hearts of the ummah. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep us all on the siratul mustaqim, siratul nabiyyina wa siddiqina wa shuhada wa salihina wa hasuna ulaika rafiqa. Wa sallallahu ala sayyidina Muhammadin wa alihi wa sahabi ajma'in. Wa akhiru da'wana an alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.
Jazakumullah khairan, Sheikh Fakhruddin. I am sure that everybody will take heed. And it boils down to one thing, and that is husnul dhan, and that is to have a good opinion of one another. Today, because somebody utters something, or they have a different view, or they perform something in a different manner that we perform, then we have a very bad opinion about them. So have a husnul dhan at all times, have a good opinion of one another, and respect one another, even if they differ with us. And that is very, very important. Jazakumullah khairan, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward you abundantly and eternally, inshaAllah, and shower you with His mercy and blessings, and grant you your health and strength to continue the wonderful work that you are doing within the Ummah. You are truly an ambassador for Islam and spreading the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I see they are collecting already. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you and protect you and guide you all for your donations and contributions that you give in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But I have to mention two things, and that is, first of all, we have lost one of our musallis of the masjid, our brother Akbar Kala, who passed away in Polokwane. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant him a high place in Jannah. He was a regular musalli here. We all know him by his beautiful white beard and white hair that he had. Always used to be in the first saf, and then when he became sick, he used to be sitting at the back on the chair. But may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant sabr to his family and his loved ones, inshallah. And then we have lost one of our icons, one of our ambassadors who served us for so many years, and that is Sheikh Musa Gowder, that have passed on. We laid him to rest yesterday. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant him a high place in Jannah, inshallah. A man who truly was a man of the Qur'an. And we can only ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as he lived with the Qur'an, by the Qur'an, that this Qur'an be an intercessor for him the day of Qiyamah, inshallah. Be the intercessor for him while he is in his grave. Because he was a person who had an exemplary character. That is something we could learn from Sheikh Musa. Because he always was a humble person. And we can all learn from that particular character. And